You want more weird stories? We got more weird stories. Welcome back, Nerd Squad. It's time to get weird again with me as we revisit the marvelous world of what ifs. Join me as we count down the top 10 weird what if comics part 2, where we will be counting down and revisiting even more strange and bizarre hypothetical stories that take place across many different alternate dimensions. What are we waiting for? Let's get counting. Number 10, what if Dr. Doom became the Thing? In this one shot, we get to see an alternate reality where instead of Ben Grimm being present when the FF first transformed, Victor Von Doom was in his place instead. He found himself, while in his armor, transformed into the Thing, while the rest of the team was granted the same powers as normal. Ben Grimm ends up actually getting caught in a radioactive explosion when a reactor blows, which transforms him then into the Hulk, and he and Doom slash the Thing battle it out. In the end, Hulk Grimm is about to smash Thing Doom, but is talked down by the rest of the FF. So, like, put that rock down. Calm down. It's all good, Ben. He ends up joining them while Doom still becomes the team's villain, bearing very different scars because, you know, under his mask, he's the Thing! Number 9. What if Spider-Man's parents destroyed his family? This story takes an already ridiculous one and offers us another take on it. Although, to be fair, I actually like this version of the story better, to be honest. Remember when Chameleon made those robots to act as Peter's parents just to, I don't know, reveal them as fakes and torment him? Well, in this story, his fake robo parents are even worse. They end up murdering Aunt May and Mary Jane and make sure that Spider-Man is framed for the murders. In retaliation, while on the run from the law, Spider-Man, pushed to his breaking point, kills Chameleon and his robo parents, getting back at them for good before turning himself into the authorities. It's a much darker take on this story. So dark. Before we move on to this next spot, just a reminder to click that like if you haven't already if you're enjoying this video. It really helps us out a ton. Number 8. What if Aunt May died instead of Uncle Ben? This one actually changed things up quite a bit, turning Peter Parker from the life of being a hero to more of a delinquent just scraping by. Everything in Peter's origins goes the same except Uncle Ben being shot. Aunt May is shot during a burglary at her home instead while she is there alone. Uncle Ben was out picking up a gallon of milk, and both he and Peter arrive home to find the police and Aunt May's corpse. It's then that Peter decides to very dramatically reveal he is Spider-Man. This part's just really ridiculous, but I love it. He goes after the burglar, ready to kill the man for taking his aunt's life. In the end, the thief falls out of a window just as Uncle Ben arrives on the scene. Rather than let Peter take the rap when the police show up or confess what truly happened, because he could just be like, that person just fell out a window, Uncle Ben confesses to killing the man for murdering his wife, even though he didn't. Ben goes to jail, and without anyone to guide him, Peter gives up being Spider-Man. He does, however, don the costume once more to put JJ in his place for coming after him after the death of his son, John Jameson, who in this reality wasn't rescued by Spider-Man, because Spider-Man wasn't Spider-Man at the time. He also calls JJ some pretty harsh names, considering the guy recently lost his son. Geez, Spidey. Basically, if Peter Parker doesn't have Aunt May to guide him, he's kind of a jerk and is kind of terrible. So that's what I learned about that. Uncle Ben is not as good as Aunt May, apparently. Number 7. What if Green Goblin stole the Infinity Gauntlet? I personally love how this story just jumps right into it. The introduction reminds us of both the Dark Reign and Infinity events, and then they just jump right into Norman Osborn murdering his originally owned Dark Avenger, Sentry, with the Infinity Gauntlet. Wow. Also, how is Norman even able to wield such a powerful weapon? Because he's just like a normal human, right? Or, I don't know, maybe his craziness from his Green Goblin stuff makes him possible to hold it? I don't know. I guess he just is, because what ifs. In this alternate universe, it's revealed that Norman Osborn takes the gauntlet and uses it to reshape the world and, by assumption, also the entire galaxy in his image, all to get back at his dad for mistreating him years earlier. In the end, Thanos shows up to claim what is his, but with the power of the gauntlet, Norman makes short work of him. Thanos also weirdly comes in telling Norman that no amount of power will ever get him the love he seeks. Kind of a weird line for Thanos there. After the battle is won, Norman responds while standing over Thanos' charred remains, "My only wish is for power. Love is for fools." He then ends up killing his father from the past in a rage, and as such perishes himself because of a time paradox. Because if you kill your dad from the past, you can't exist. Although I think at that point in his life, his dad may have had him as a child, so I don't know. But that's the end. poof, it's gone. Number 6. What if Conan the Barbarian walked the Earth today? Half of this what if story is just meant to re-establish Conan and explain how he gets to modern day New York. But when he does arrive, it is a pretty crazy and strange time. This apparently, according to the cover anyways, was the most requested and highly anticipated what if of the day when the first volume of what ifs was happening in the 70s. Conan, upon arriving in the modern day, has a lot of weird and, in his opinion, I'm sure disturbing experiences. One sees him harassed by an elderly woman who hits him with her bag because she believes he is too scantily clad. She's like, cover up your bottom, sir. Cover that up. Conan doesn't like this very much, and so he dumps her in a trash can. Literally, she's just stuck in it, and I'm just like, wow, Conan, that's pretty intense. She's just an old lady. He then runs into a cab driver, striking her vehicle with a sword, believing it's a monster. She ends up taking pity on him though, saying she senses he is mostly harmless, despite the fact that he is super muscly, looks pretty angry most of the time, and just struck her cab with a freaking sword. In the end, Conan disappears from New York and is transported away when he is struck by a bolt of lightning, which does not seem to really surprise the police officers who witnessed that. I guess in modern day New York, where superheroes exist, life is so fantastical that nothing really fazes you. Also, maybe that's just the 70s. Like, maybe in the 70s people got struck by bolts of lightning and disappeared, and people were like, that's totally a normal 70s thing to happen. I don't know, I wasn't alive in the 70s, so I don't know if that's true or not. Number 5. What if Vision of the Avengers conquered the world? Time to answer that burning question you always wanted answered. What if Vision of the Avengers had conquered the world? No? Did no one need this question answered? Well, too bad, because you're getting an answer. Vision is a supremely intelligent android, so if you're thinking this will probably end well for Earth, you're not completely wrong. Vision ruling does bring about peace and an end to poverty and hunger initially, but he also places Earth and its heroes in an intergalactic war where they are forced to take on the Skrull and the Kree. And in the end, he's also responsible for the decline of civilization somewhat when humans rebel against his rule and take out New York City in an attempt to harm Vision, as his mainframe is stored there. When this fails and also eliminates millions of innocent lives as well as most of the superhero community, the humans turn on technology and evolve into further anarchy and chaos. Yikes. So basically, we shouldn't let Vision rule the Earth. That's the moral of this story. It's not gonna end well, probably. Number 4. What if Prince Namor of Atlantis grew up on land? I feel like a lot of the other heroes and teams that were highlighted in this early 2000s batch of what-ifs got much more interesting concepts thrown their way. The answer to this what-if is likely just what you imagine. Namor is kind of just less impressive. It starts off after Namor gets teased for being unable to swim. A Namor that can't swim. Yeah. Although I do feel bad for him getting teased, but still, I was like, wow, this is the reality we're in. He still ends up fighting alongside the allies and heroes of World War II, but without the power of Atlantis at his back, as he turns away from his heritage, instead choosing to ally himself with the land dwellers, instead of oppose them. In the end, however, when he's ordered to blow up his people because of their proximity to the enemy, he refuses, and does end up returning to Atlantis, but too late, as his people still end up getting blown up in the crossfire. Like most what-ifs, Namor is left returning to the man we know him to be, the avenging son of his people and of the sea. It's like swimming, and he's like, I can swim now, and also, I'm gonna avenge these people that died. Not Atlantis, no. Number 3. What if Captain America were revived today? This story is both weird and amazing. Also, I believe there are two versions of it, so to clarify, the one we're talking about here is from the 77 What If series, issue number 44. This story imagines what if we got the fake Cap before we got the real Cap. If you don't know that story, it comes from a retcon where Marvel chose to explain away the fact that Cap was supposedly around during the time we later said he was frozen. The retcon goes that the Cap and Bucky we saw after the original pair's disappearance at the end of World War II were actually fakes, who were driven mad from exposure to the super soldier serum, which obviously didn't work as well as it had with the original Cap. The fake Cap being revived first revealed just how intense he was when he started going after people he deemed communists and insisting that certain Americans, such as the youth and minorities, were far too divided and should be more patriotic. Fortunately, we come to the present day where the real Captain America is revived. He takes on the imposter here, and we get a pretty sweet cap on cap fight where the real Captain America actually tells the imposter that the USA only needs him as a reminder of basically how not to be. He goes on to speak to the people after defeating the crazed imposter that he told you that Americans were the greatest people, that America could be refined like silver, could have the impurities hammered out of it and shine more brightly. He went on about how precious America was, how you needed to make sure it remained great, and he told you anything was justified to preserve that great treasure, that pearl of great price that is America. Well, I say America is nothing without its ideals, its commitment to the freedom of all men. America is a piece of trash. He goes on to remind people it's not the flag they should fight for, but the freedom that makes this nation and its people great, and reminds people that they need to work to protect those freedoms for all Americans, not sacrifice them for the promise of greatness. It's also just like, it's a weird issue and it's a great issue. That speech at the end is like, it's beautiful. You should all read it. It's pretty great. Number 2, what if Betty Brant was bitten by the radioactive spider instead? This is the second tale in the what if someone else besides Spider-Man had been bitten by the radioactive spider issue. You might know about Flash and John Jameson, but do you remember Betty's story from this one, wedged in between the stories belonging to those two gents? It is actually super ridiculous. Betty faints when she is bitten because she actually can't stand spiders and they make her queasy. Her powers surface while she's off to coffee with Peter and smashes the table in a rage while talking about her infuriating boss, JJ. It also features one of the most ridiculous Spider-Woman costumes I have ever seen. It's so ridiculous, oh my goodness. Number 1, what if the original Marvel bullpen had become the Fantastic Four? Yep, this what if story is pretty crazy, and it imagines what the Fantastic Four might be like if some of the original Marvel staff were transformed by cosmic radio waves into the FF themselves. It features Stan Lee as Mr. Fantastic, Sol Brodsky as the Human Torch, appropriate considering his first name, Jack Kirby with almost pinkish or purple hued hair in this issue as the Thing, and finally fabulous Flo Steinberg as the Invisible Woman. It all happens after the team receives a gift from a mysteriously glossy eyed fan. It turns out the gift is some kind of contraption that the team thinks is a radio, but then it seems to blast them with a bunch of superpower granting cosmic rays, or their radio equivalent. The story sees the Marvel staff FF crossing paths with Namor and even taking on Skrulls. So many gloriously strange stories, and there have been quite a few featuring Conan the Barbarian himself too. Which hero do you think has the most bizarre what if stories? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. I think personally that Conan has gotta be up there. He's got some pretty weird ones. Thank you so much for watching. This has been Top 10 Nerd, and I'm your host Amanda McKnight, reminding you till next time to stay nerdy, YouTube.